Reality is like a film set. There are directors.
Action.
Producers.
Are we on schedule?
And even actors.
Can somebody get me a coffee?
The trick is realizing that you are playing all of these roles. You are the executive producer of your reality. My name is Daniel.
My name is Lauren.
And we're here to break the fourth wall to discover what's behind the scenes. And what you hear just might have you saying,
"That's so meta."
Welcome, everybody, to That's So Meta, where we discuss the mystical, the magical, and the metaphysical. I'm your host, Daniel James.
And I'm your co-host, Lauren Marie.
And it is the end of September 2022.
Mm-hmm.
And once again, we have not done an episode in several months.
Yeah.
I think our last episode was the guest interview with Daniel Scranton. So if you haven't seen that one, go ahead and check it out. He's a very fascinating, very interesting friend of mine. And the reason why we haven't done an episode in several months is because we have been busy. Summer is our busiest season for the video business, The Moment Imaging. Our videography service is like full-time right now, which is great.
Yeah.
It's just very busy.
Yeah, it's kind of our MO. We show up one episode every 6 months, I think is a good formula for us at this point.
It's really just a Daniel and Lauren update show. It's like this is like a vlog now in our lives.
It's basically just for our families.
Yeah.
Like they also have not seen us. So.
And this video is to update mom and dad on what we're up to. And
yeah, this is like FaceTime.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I've been super busy. The thing about how busy we are is that it becomes so normal so quickly, at least to me, mm-hmm. because like when I call my dad or whoever and they're like, "Oh, what have you been up to?" And I'm like, "Do you want to hang out tonight?" And I'm like, "I can't, I'm busy." And they're like, "What are you doing?" And I'm like, "A little of everything," yeah. Honestly, but I can't, like, it's so much all the time that like I can't separate it anymore.
That's right.
So it feels like, you know, someone's like, "Hey, do you want to get dinner tonight?" And I'm like, "No, I'm editing," you know? But yeah, so I don't know. I mean, we've been so busy, but like, I can't even think about all the stuff that we've done. We've been working on a project.
A movie.
A movie project. We've been working for clients. We've been doing weddings this summer. What else we've been up to?
Traveling for work.
Mm-hmm. Lots of travel.
Yeah. We got our guy that we work full-time for from Philadelphia. Amazing man, Mr. KB Power, is a friend of mine and somebody that I have worked for professionally as a videographer for going on 10 years. And as he grows and scales in his respective journey and as his projects and endeavors grow, I grow with him. And so the busier he is, sometimes the busier I am, which is a great partnership he and I have.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the things that we've been doing so much lately, along with the sci-fi film.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all very fun and exciting.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a one or two little metaphysical chats for you on this episode. We hadn't really come to a definitive conclusion on it, on like a topic. We used to do definitive lectures on a topic. Today, we're kind of just going to flow it out, give you guys a couple general updates and go from there. Let it fly. You know?
Mm-hmm.
Lauren's looking very beautiful, by the way, in this episode.
Thank you. I will say, one of the multiple sets of earrings that I'm wearing at the moment, they are UFO mm-hmm. earrings. And this ties into something else that we've done recently, which is go to the Kecksburg UFO Festival. Not recently, it was months ago, but it's still just as exciting. We went to visit the Kecksburg UFO crash where we filmed our documentary.
The Bermuda Triangle of Pennsylvania. Have you seen it? It's got almost 1,600 views on YouTube right now.
It's very exciting.
Go check it out.
So we were able to visit Kecksburg while they had their UFO fest, and there was lots of vendors there. We made a couple friends. We got to see a couple friends.
That's right.
And that was a good time.
We're the kind of people that like to go to like conventions, mm-hmm. the UFO festivals.
And just like talk to people.
Network. There are a lot of people that, you know, we resonate with, and, you know, we're cryptid hunters,
mm-hmm.
you know, so those are our people. Mm-hmm. We did miss, unfortunately, we missed the Mothman Festival this year.
I was very excited to see that.
We keep trying to go every year and something comes up. We just missed it, but we do like to go to those events a lot. They're a lot of fun. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's good to like meet people that kind of like know what you're talking about, like, and they have their own stories. Because I feel like a lot of the time when I'm like, oh yeah, Mothman, somebody's like, I've never even heard of that. So it's cool to meet people that are like, oh, I saw him and I did
everybody
this
thing. That you go
and like, have you heard of this creature and all that stuff, and like trading stories in the regional like monsters and
sharing
stuff
the locals that have seen the same things you have, which is a lot of fun.
Yeah,
we're kind of weirdos and we talk about these things to our friends and family, and some of them think it's cool and fun and cute, and other ones are like, oh, that's kind of weird. Yeah, whatever you say, Dan. But when you go to places like this, like, everyone is in on it.
Yeah, it's like a community.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, listen, couple announcements, rapid fire. My alternative podcast, Celestial Oddities, Pair of Normal Guys, we had just got back into doing season 3, which is a lot of fun, with my partner, Freighter Crow, who's been on That's So Meta as well. If you go back and look at the episode, Garrett Jagerman, that's my buddy. We're up in the air on that show right after we got back to season 3. I know my partner Garrett has been very busy with moving. He just bought a new house, and he also recently had a baby. And so he's been very busy. But as it would be, as it were, people like us, you know, generally are in the public eye for one reason or another. We're often, you know, watched on social media, and my partner Garrett had all of his social media deleted by the corporations who classified him as a domestic terrorist, which I can assure you he is not.
How bizarre.
Yeah, so he got a hold of me and let me know that his, you know, Facebook account had been deleted. And his Instagram is gone. And these are the main platforms that we use to market and advertise our shows. So that being said, you know, he's on the fence whether or not he wants to continue with any of his shows. He has multiple radio shows and podcasts that he hosts, including Celestial Oddities. So I am fighting for the show. We don't know if we're going to keep doing it or if he wants to go ahead and maybe finish out season 3. But I think he's sort of like taking this opportunity as to sort of take a step back from, you know, social media, which is healthy for anybody, and focus on his work and his job and his family and just do his own thing. So what I can tell you guys is go to Spreaker or just do an internet search for Celestial Oddities, Pair of Normal Guys. We have an awesome seasons 1 and 2 with a lot of fascinating topics similar to this show, even more so in the esoteric. And we did go ahead and do a welcome back episode for season 3, but listen to the old stuff. You know, there's good content there, and we'll do an update on whether or not Celestial Oddities is going to continue.
Yeah. It's so frustrating because social media, like, I personally try to stay away from social media because I don't have any, like,
Lauren barely uses
practical,
it.
For me personally, I don't have any practical use for it. But I understand it to be a great place for connection and meeting with like-minded people.
Networking.
And also for business use. I think the most social media use that I do is just business related, just for our videography company.
Yeah.
So I understand how devastating it would be, not only on like a social level, but on like a business level, how devastating it would be to lose that platform. Mm-hmm. Because now you have a choice. You either have to decide, like, is this kind of like a divine intervention? I can release this sort of thing, or do I have to push past this in order to like prove that I deserve it or whatever? So, that's really difficult. I hope the show comes back because even I listen to it.
Yeah. I record the episodes at home like we do this one. And Lauren will sometimes be out in the living room and pull the show up and listen to it out there while it's happening live from the office.
Yeah.
So Celestial Oddities. In other news, I do actually want to touch on this tiny little thing. I offer a service. As many of you know, I've channeled. I know how to channel. I have channeled in the past, but I don't really particularly offer that as a service anymore. Instead, what I became really passionate about is teaching people how to get into the channeling state, how to do what I call the spirit contact protocol. Now, this is an exercise that anybody entry level who's new to this type of thing can do, or anybody that's a seasoned veteran but hasn't learned how to connect to spirit in this way, I've designed my own spirit contact tool that we did a commercial for several months ago. Mm-hmm. But we've been so busy, I haven't finished it. There's a couple scenes I need to shoot for that, but
still in production.
Right. So this is a service that I do offer through my website, and I do get bookings for through networking and word of mouth, but I do want to market and advertise this a little bit more because I'm feeling called to help people, you know, get in touch with their spirit teams, which is what this does. So it's called the Spirit Contact Protocol. And I'm just finishing up the commercial now as we speak, which will be here on my YouTube channel. It'll be on my website. It'll be on my social media. You can check it out, which will give you an introduction into what this exercise is and how powerful and effective it can be for anybody that wants to communicate to spirit. So I wanted to make that little formal announcement on that service that I offer. I am open for bookings, and there will be a cool, flashy commercial for that here coming very soon.
And I can attest to its ability to put you into a meditative state.
Yes.
I think what's really unique about your service is that it is a contact tool that you can access and you can use to contact, you know, spirit guides, past relatives, all that stuff. But it also just is a good tool to use to teach you how to meditate,
you know,
because I know a lot of people struggle with that.
That's ultimately, you know, the first principle of why I built it. The most common question that I've gotten over the years is, Daniel, I can't silence and quiet my mind to meditate. How do I meditate? So I thought about, okay, well, let's say people are always, you know, getting distracted by their thoughts. Or maybe you're somebody who has tried to meditate, but you need like music and incense, or you need whale sounds playing in the background, or you're distracted by the lawnmower outside or the kids playing in the next room, whatever it is that's distracting to you that can't put you into a meditative state. This exercise is designed specifically to integrate all of your 3D senses, and anything that could serve as a distraction in your 3D reality, we're actually using those as anchoring tools that draw you deeper into the self and then sort of almost walk you into the meditation through the distraction. So we're using those, not trying to silence them and shut them out. So that's mm-hmm. my favorite aspect of the whole thing, is if anybody, you know, just wants to meditate and learn how to get more into a focused, centered, grounded space, this exercise can do that too, let alone send you to whole other realities.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So there is a topic that I wanted to touch on today, and this is the topic of Mercury retrograde, which is what we're technically going through right now. There's like 6 bazillion planets in retrograde or something to that effect, if you're into astrology, astronomy, things like that. If you're in the spiritual communities or you're in the new age communities, you've probably heard this term, Mercury is in retrograde, right? You've heard of it, right?
Yeah. I definitely look like somebody who would know about astrology, but I have not one clue. I have the same attitude as most of the internet, where I'm like, which planet's making me sad? Like, how much longer is Mercury in the microwave? You know, like...
Like that meme where it's like, Mercury's in retrograde, it's making me miserable. And then it cuts to them in the Mercury, and Mercury's like, bitch, who the fuck are you? You know what I mean? Are you? Like, what are you? It's like a little, what? You
know, I totally, I love it. I love
it's
that. And I would like to know phenomenon. More about it. But I am not one who knows very much about astrology, unfortunately, right. Despite the way that I present myself.
The internet says that when the planet Mercury enters an apparent retrograde motion, that marks the beginning of a span of misfortune down on Earth. Mm-hmm. At least that is according to proponents of astrology. That's the internet.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're a new ager, if you're into, you know, the spiritual aspect of life, you're familiar with this concept.
Yeah.
So what I want to say is, my remark on that, it's appropriate to do an episode about this because it's happening right now to us. I'm not a new ager. I'm into spirit science.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a metaphysicist, okay? But I am studied and exercised in a lot of new age philosophy. So if you follow my social media, one thing I always say is, when it comes to, say, for example, the blood moon, the new moon, the Lionsgate portal every August, or even New Year's resolutions, okay? These are things that are very anchored in linear time. Time in terms of cause and effect. So what I notice people doing, whether conscious or unconscious, is they like to assign all this meaning, and they like to give all this power to a specific celestial event that almost like gives them permission to make a change, or it gives them a reason to feel bad or misfortune, or it gives them a skyrocketing propulsion of energy through the Lionsgate portal to have an ascension of consciousness. Whatever these definitions are to you, I'm being very general here. Specifically, New Year's resolution is one of my favorites. When you're on social media and everybody's like, my New Year's resolution is to change this and to quit that and to start that. I'm like, okay. And you needed to wait how many days, weeks, months, or a year to make that decision for yourself?
Well, it's like when you're a kid and you're like, I'll start my homework at 3 o'clock. And then 3 o'clock like passes, you miss it by like 2 minutes. And you're right. Like, you're right, it should be 3:30. You know what I mean? It's just that like, it's a thing that people do.
It's a thing that people do. It's a cultural thing. And I get it, because we are a civilization that likes to, you know, go with the mass consensus generally. So for New Year's resolutions, you do not need a new year to quit that bad habit. You do not need a new year or a new day to make that positive change in your life, or to take action on the thing that you know you want to do that spirit has been calling you for, but you've been putting off. That's a permission slip that you're giving the power to the new year, to saying it's a new year to start again, to press on. Okay, that's fine if that helps you. But oftentimes, if we're using times and dates and celestial events as an excuse to motivate us into either identifying with negative circumstances that are happening in your life with Mercury retrograde, or the opportunity for positive change like a new year, these are permission slips that you are giving yourself to motivate you into making some sort of change, or identifying why things are a way that they are, more specifically Mercury retrograde. For as long as I can remember, even before a spiritual awakening, I've heard about this through people, you know, mediums and psychics and tarot readers, astrology. They tell you, oh, Mercury's in retrograde 3 times a year, and when it happens, your fucking life is gonna suck.
Yeah.
Says fucking who? I am creator. I am driving the wheel. As Abraham Hicks would say, I am the deliberate creator of my reality. So I'm gonna get to like a point here. I'm ranting a little bit, but I usually do. So why is it that we are just blindly accepting what we're taught, what we're told, that this planet somewhere in space, or multiple planets somewhere in space, these celestial bodies, are negatively affecting our Earth, negatively affecting our reality and our lives and our personal circumstances? Are we using this as some sort of negative crutch to be depressed, to feel frustrated? Oh, my electronics aren't working because Mercury. Oh, I stubbed my pinky toe so bad I can't fucking see straight because of Mercury. Oh, yeah, I got a, you know, fender bender because Mercury. Okay. Well, you're assigning a lot of meaning to that. You're giving this celestial body, this thing outside of your immediate 3D senses, a lot of power over you. So, pro tip. Here's today's lecture, guys. Is it possible that Mercury or another planet moving backwards can somehow ruin your fucking day? Maybe. Okay. But that is a belief that you're holding on to, which is something that you're choosing to subscribe to, something that you accept, that you agree to, that you are allowing to have power over you. In this case, a lot of negative circumstances over your life. Now, I don't particularly like that. It doesn't feel good to me to say, oh, well, I'm having a bad day and it's Mercury's fault. So all I have to do is sit here and twiddle my fucking thumbs for the next week until Mercury is not going backwards anymore, and now my life can be okay again. No, I disagree, okay? Here's how you circumvent and bypass and get through Mercury retrograde as a sovereign creator of your reality, as a deliberate being, right? You can choose that you are creating your own reality, and choose not to give power away to this planet that is seemingly making your life difficult, This is a choice. It isn't an empirical fact that I believe in, that this particular planet, outside of my awareness, is deliberately making my life challenging and trying to make me unhappy. Listen, it's not promoting any shadow work. It's not forcing me into some sort of ascension, okay? It's something that people talk about 3 times a year. You see a lot of memes on the internet. You see a lot of Facebook posts about how Mercury's in retrograde, so my light bulb exploded and I dropped my coffee, you know, and oh man, funny memes, jokes, it'll be over soon. Okay, but like, why are we doing this every year? How many times do we have to just let this Mercury retrograde thing control our lives? Or can we just stop and choose and say, I am creator? I'm good, please.
I like what you're saying. I think ultimately, no matter what, it's important to always take your power back, regardless of the situations. But counterpoint, what if the Gatorade is causing all of this misfortune to happen to a person? And because the misfortune's happening, they grow, they change.
So you're saying that
it promotes shadow work. Okay. So like, for example, because the planets are spinning backwards and something happens where your like computer dies, but you work from home, that can kind of promote a sort of obstacle for you to, even if you don't know anything about the planets at all, misfortune can oftentimes promote growth through overcoming it.
I see.
You know what I mean?
I see.
So it could be, I understand, I know what point you're making, but it could also be a type of growth. But don't, whatever happens to you, I guess the point is, learn from whatever misfortune you're going through, learn from whatever accidents happen, like you spill your coffee and then you're late for work and then your tire's flat and all this stuff. You can either learn from it or you can blame it on something else. And
that's my problem, is I don't want people kind blaming.
Of wipe away the responsibility of that's handling right. it. Something that I heard a long time ago was, say a tree falls onto your car.
Sure.
It's not your fault that the tree fell, but it is your responsibility to get your car fixed.
I see.
Does that make sense? So there's a difference between like fault and responsibility.
And shifting blame.
And shifting blame. So understanding that something else is at fault for a thing happening to you does not mean that you are absolved of the responsibility of learning from it and overcoming
it. And that might be my main point that I'm getting at, is that people can use Mercury retrograde as an excuse, like if in a victim way, that their daily misfortune with their electronics and whatever else is going challenging in their day is because of this Mercury retrograde, and they can't wait for it to be over so that their lives can go back to being in their control.
Yeah.
Okay. So with Mercury retrograde, my point is that, is it possible that this celestial planet, this body, this being is maybe energetically forcing some sort of ascensional growth or promoting some positive shadow work? But what I want people to know is that you can choose the way that it affects you. Mm-hmm. Remind yourself that you are a conscious creator being, and you don't have to be negatively affected by this planet. You don't have to just go along with the internet memes and the Facebook posts about how this Mercury retro, six planets in retrograde, are making my life miserable. Mm-hmm. You're in control. And if you want to spin this so that when these things happen, it's promoting some shadow work and some growth and some positive change in your life, just remember that it is doing that for you as a tool, and that you're not a victim to it.
Exactly.
So Lauren actually had a really interesting note about divine timing. What were you going to...
Yeah, like for example, say Mercury or another planet puts some obstacles in your way while you're trying to accomplish like some task. Like for example, maybe, I don't know, like a short film. And there's all these obstacles coming up and it's delaying the process of completing the task. It's important to always remember that everything happens in divine timing, and no matter what it feels like at the time, you will realize after the fact why it had to be that way. Does that make
right.
sense?
That's right. It's and like that, that's a good point.
It's like the story of that farmer called Maybe or whatever. You know what I'm talking about. Shia LaBeouf just talked about this recently.
Yeah.
But I heard about it before that. Where, you know, this guy on a farm loses a horse and he's yeah. like,
oh, we
somebody
can't.
Says, that's terrible. And he we says, maybe yeah. the next day the horse comes back and it brings a bunch of
more horses.
And they're like, wow, it's great. You have all these free horses. And the guy says, maybe. And then one of his sons is riding one of the wild horses and falls off and breaks his leg. And they're like, oh, that's terrible.
Yeah.
And he's like, maybe. And then the next day, a bunch of people come into town and they're like, we're taking all the healthy boys for war, but your son has a broken leg, so he gets to stay home. That's great. Maybe. So no matter what happens, there's always like a divine purpose for it.
Right.
You broke your leg, but now you don't have to go to war.
That's right.
You know?
That's a good point. And that segues into, we want to talk about OMA, which is our big sci-fi epic. Now, I am somebody who has a long history, many years in a row, of doing a movie every summer. I usually shoot a film in August into September, and that sort of seems to be like my cycle that I like a lot. So we did Those Who Seek in August. We did The Inbound Interception in August. We've done some, you know, other independent films in August, September, October. And this year is no different. In August and September, October, we're doing OMA, which is my big sci-fi epic. And if you are new to my channel or you've been on my channel, you may have seen my announcement film, my announcement video for that. We have a website. Please go to it right now. It's called storyofoma.com. Mm-hmm. And it will tell you everything that you need to know about this movie that is so near and dear to my heart. Maybe the most important thing that I may ever do. And we have been in we did pre-production for almost 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And the reason why pre-production took so long is two reasons. Number one, OMA is an acronym for something very important to me. And it's part and parcel to the concept of doing mostly everything yourself,
mm-hmm.
which means this is a skeleton crew. This is a very grassroots,
mm-hmm.
Two producer effort.
Mm-hmm.
Me and Lauren are pretty much building this movie, by ourselves,
mm-hmm.
other than, you know, the people that helped us pay for it and, the crew that we hire.
Mm-hmm.
So we're the full-time producers. Now, the pre-production took a long time because there's just one or two of us.
Mm-hmm.
And also because this is a sci-fi movie that's got a genre that's kind of like a little bit of Blade Runner,
mm-hmm.
a little bit of like Altered Carbon, a little mm-hmm. bit of Star Wars. And so when you have that sort of cyberpunk, dystopian, sci-fi genre, I want to tell you guys, it's very expensive to do.
Yeah.
It takes a lot of planning and preparation to even get close to the look that you want without mm-hmm. a huge crew and a huge team. So getting all of that organized has been one of the biggest challenges in my filmmaking career, which rightfully so. A good friend of mine told me recently that, you know, this is Mr. Kirk Berry speaking, that the bigger opportunities you have can often come with equally bigger challenges.
Mm-hmm.
And the more you grow in your skill sets and the more talented you become, you can oftentimes encounter challenges that are that big.
Think about it like playing a video game.
It gets harder as it progresses.
You keep beating bosses until you get like to the final boss, and then you do it and it's done and it's accomplished.
I love that analogy. OMA is my boss battle.
It truly is.
Facts, okay? To do this movie by myself with the help of Lauren and a few people, because of the genre. Now, if this was a average horror film or a drama,
mm-hmm.
or a romance film or a comedy, listen, you can do those movies for almost nothing,
mm-hmm.
with minimal crew,
mm-hmm.
and it comes out great.
Mm-hmm.
But when you're doing a dystopian sci-fi epic,
mm-hmm.
with two people, I'm telling you guys, I love this journey. I love the challenge. I love the process. The last 20 something years of my life have been culminating into this pinnacle,
mm-hmm.
this crescendo, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
But everything that I've learned as a filmmaker and everything that I've, in all the areas that I've grown as a filmmaker, have been put to the test in this movie,
mm-hmm.
because of how small the crew is, and when Lauren and I are doing everything alone,
mm-hmm.
and because of the genre, the preparation it takes to execute the aesthetic of this genre.
Mm-hmm.
Biggest challenge of my entire life,
mm-hmm.
creatively, as a filmmaker. Mm-hmm. And we're doing it. We're in it right now. We mm-hmm. have been filming. We've got some scenes filmed. We're filming another scene this month. We have two more scenes to film next month. Mm-hmm. And so if you're interested in OMA and you're following the progress of it, I will be doing an official update on the website soon. Mm-hmm. I'll do a text update and also a video update similar to what you're hearing now. But just know that we are working on this movie. Mm-hmm. And just know that we are still working on it. And we're going to be shooting this into November. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. And that's just for the first episode, guys. OMA is going to be a web series that is 6 episodes long. Okay? And they're short episodes. They're a couple minutes. Each episode will more essentially be a scene. Mm-hmm. But it is very involved. And it is very time consuming. And it is very challenging. Mm-hmm. And Lauren, I got to tell you on record here, you're amazing and you've been so helpful. And guys, she's shooting the movie. My sweet Lauren, who runs our video company together, she's the main camera operator. She's the main camera person. So when you see the film, she shot it, okay? And if I'm not in the scene as the lead actor, remember when I said this is very grassroots, very skeleton crew? Small crew. I'm shooting everything that I'm not. Mm-hmm. Every scene that I'm not in, mm-hmm. and everything that I am in, Lauren is shooting. So thank you for your hard work.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the sleepless nights and the stress and the love. This is a passion. It's a labor of love, this movie.
Yeah.
And the first episode, we estimate will be done filming.
You don't want to put a timeline on
this year.
Well,
we will be done.
Well,
we will be done filming soon. And what's nice is as we're in post-production and we're doing music and visual effects on the first episode, we're filming the other episodes. So those installments will be coming out after the initial film, but they will all work together as a puzzle that helps add more context and builds more story to the first episode. It's very interesting the way we've crafted these 6 episodes. They actually all tie into the first. Mm-hmm. So it's like an unraveling puzzle.
Yeah.
The way we've crafted it. So I'm very proud.
I'm so proud of how everything's gone so far, but I don't think anything else in my life has ever proved the divine timing point to me.
That's right.
More than this project.
Yeah, that's why I mentioned
because
it.
There have been so many moments while doing this that like we're just what feels like we're so close to just being totally defeated by certain things, right. But then it turns around and it goes amazing.
Yeah.
And it
comes through at the last minute.
Perfectly lines up like dominoes, you know. Mm-hmm. So without getting into specifics of things that have happened,
there have been expectations, there have been plans for things that have been lined up as a producer would do that have not come into play the way we expected.
But ultimately so many things have worked out by like the grace of the universe too. So this whole experience has just been very eye-opening, like more than I could ever appreciate in my life.
You're right. And I want to seal that point that you made so beautifully is when it comes to the divine timing, Lauren and one of our producers, our good, sweet, dear friend, Tony. Hey, Tony. Okay. We love you.
We love you so much.
Is it with divine timing, I had a plan and a schedule to shoot certain scenes for OMA. Okay. It is the end of September when you see this. And we wanted to wrap filming of the first episode in August. Mm-hmm. Okay? And we're not even halfway done filming. Mm-hmm. What that means is I have realized as a filmmaker and a producer that I had an idea and an expectation of how I wanted those scenes to go and when I wanted them filmed by. But by the time that we actually got to filming that scene or got to shooting that particular date, we wouldn't have been ready mm-hmm. in other areas mm-hmm. of the production, maybe mm-hmm. this particular prop, that wardrobe item, mm-hmm. This type of day that we wanted to shoot in. It wouldn't have come together the way that I wanted it to mm-hmm. as quickly as I had anticipated with the original production schedule of the film. Mm-hmm. So now we're trusting the journey more. Mm-hmm. We're allowing divine timing to come, and these scenes are being filmed when they're most synchronous to do so. Mm-hmm. And I'm not rushing them a minute sooner mm-hmm. just to get the film done, mm-hmm. just to get it like finished and go into post mm-hmm. because I don't want to rush this process. Yeah. And I don't want to make any irreversible mistakes. So in trusting the divine timing, we're actually more prepared to shoot the scenes when we shoot them than we would have been if I would have crammed everything in the month of August. Mm-hmm. So that was a beautiful point that you made in regards to divine timing, is that you trust the synchronicities.
Yeah, I'm just so thrilled to be working on this. I'm so grateful for how much working on it has expanded my creative abilities, you know, because like
absolutely
I did Holbrook and I love that movie, but it was mostly just like a jumping off point.
Yeah.
And now I feel so much more confident in mm-hmm. so many areas because going of how much OMA. Responsibility I have with OMA.
Yeah. I'm total sorry, responsibility. We always talk about how like producing a film is like almost like in a sense raising a baby, giving birth to a child that you raise and teach and grow and then turn loose to the world. And every film is like that, whether it's a micro mm-hmm. 1 minute mm-hmm. experimental student film mm-hmm. or whether it's, you know, a properly financed big studio project mm-hmm. and everything in between. It's the same creative process. It is a life
yeah.
that you're building. And all of the films that I've ever done for other people as a service for myself, financed, not financed, just make movies. OMA, it's all been leading up to OMA. Mm-hmm. And it is my greatest challenge. And I think that it will be my greatest success and my greatest reward. And so we hope you guys like it when it's finally done someday. We're working on it. And
you know, it's so funny.
Trust the journey.
I am a little superstitious about certain things, but this is like the first time that I'm allowing myself to like gush over this project because I'm so excited for it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. At the time that we're recording this, we're immersed right in the middle of it.
Yeah.
We're still ordering gear.
Yeah.
And props. We're still shooting scenes. Mm-hmm. We're still building sets.
I'm still dyeing my hair right now.
Lauren plays a character. Like, remember? Skeleton crew.
Yeah.
Grassroots. Very small. Lauren plays a character. Daniel plays a character. Mm-hmm. And Lauren's dyeing her hair all these special colors, pigments to play this character who I won't spoil yet. Mm-hmm. Very important. And we're immersed in it right now, guys. That's partly why we don't do these episodes very often, because it's like we're either just like living and being adult humans mm-hmm. or we're working for a client mm-hmm. making deadlines mm-hmm. or we're shooting something mm-hmm. a wedding, traveling to Buffalo to shoot a live event, or we're making OMA.
Yeah.
Which is a full-time job. I want you to know, guys, I should have been logging the hours that I worked mm-hmm. in this movie, but I'm well over 1,000 hours labor in this.
Yeah.
Over the course of several months.
But it's like, we want to be doing it.
We want to.
That's where I want my time to go, you know?
Yeah. And we're grateful to be able to do so. So OMA, yeah. storyofoma.com, check it out. Mm-hmm. Look for updates, ask us questions. Mm-hmm. And thank you for being here and listening. Yeah. Mercury retrograde. Don't let it control your life. Or do. Mm-hmm. But just know that you have a choice. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Divine timing.
There we go.
Would you like to send us out?
Yeah. That's so meta.
That's so meta.
Thanks for watching after all this time.
Thanks for sticking with us. If you...
Mom and Dad.
Thank you
so much for listening.
Kalina. if we don't do another special Halloween episode like we did last year, have a spooky season. October's coming up. We're having a Halloween party at our house.
Yeah.
And happy fall. Happy summer. Happy wife. Happy life. We're wedding videographers, so it's like those little things sneak
in. If you would have told me 4 years ago today that I'd be standing up here next to the love of my life in front of friends, family, and God, I would have never believed you. Sorry. We love weddings, but sometimes they're cookie cutter. That's so meta. Sorry.
That's so meta.
Bye, cheers. Thank you. last thing I'm going to say is watch Everything Everywhere All at Once. It's amazing. Thank you so much for coming to my TED Talk. Bye.